The Gorecast is brought to you by American Horrors, the greatest uncut horror channel in the world. 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, all horror.
Also brought to you by iBleedIndie.com, your one-stop shop for all your horror rentals and purchases.
Don't waste $10 on a soda, relax at home with iBleedIndie.com.
Hello, and welcome to what we've decided to call the Gorecast Chats, where we
chat to somebody on a Gorecast.
That's good. Oh, as you can see, he's not here just yet because his little window's there. We're going to have a director of to Jennifer and his current movie that we're going to be chatting about, Bethany, that features Sharon Doherty,
Zack Ward,
Tom Green,
and
Stefanie Estes.
Yes.
And for any UFC fans, it's got Keith, the Dean of Mean Jardine, in it briefly, but in it nevertheless, who's also been in John Wick and Logan and Preacher, or TV show that we should do an episode about sometime.
We don't want me doing an episode.
I don't know if they want either of us doing it, but it's got to happen sometime. I think there's a effing design. So we thought we'd give you a very quick
rundown of the film, basically.
Yeah, James is just a little bit occupied on other interviews and things like that at the moment. So basically, Bethany starts off with a woman named Claire and her husband, who find themselves moving back to Claire's childhood home after they've been gone for numerous amounts of years.
She lit out of that place when she was 17.
She booked it pretty quick because Shannon Doherty, who plays her mother, is she's a little bit
sadistic, is what's the only way of putting it.
What's your word that you like to use? Your catchphrase? We're going to give you, you're getting a catchphrase now.
What catchphrase?
Cuckoo.
That's not a catchphrase.
Cuckoo, say it.
Cuckoo for Cocoa Puffs?
That's the one, perfect.
That's not okay. My catchphrase, that's from like some American cereal.
No, that's Cocoa for Cocoa Puffs.
No, it's Cuckoo for Cocoa Puffs.
Okay, well either way.
Jesus.
Either way. So anyway, she's a little bit nutty.
Everyone's a fruit and nut bar, yeah. Especially her.
Which is, seems to have been a bit of a running theme in some of the films we've had coming up recently, where the mother is a complete raging lunatic. Based on Jack.
Well, there's obviously an easy way of twisting the Oedipus complex.
That's very true. Very well thought out there. So
I
mean, anyway,
Freud spinning his grave.
Where were we? Honest. So yeah, she's back in the family home.
Yeah, she's inherited this house that she grew up in. She's clearly not exactly too thrilled to be back there because the damn thing's got all sorts of painful and ridiculously horrible memories.
She expresses that relatively clearly, actually.
Yeah.
Do not want to be here.
A little bit hesitant about letting the hubby check in certain parts.
Who's played by Zack Ward.
Yeah.
You'd know him from that TV show, Titus.
Yeah, he's awesome.
One of my favourite comedy shows of all time, actually. I love it.
Yeah, and then great he pops show up in various other bits and pieces. Usually he's an angry guy.
Yeah, he was a really, he was a mean bully in, not the name of it's gone out of my head now at the moment. But they've all moved back to the family home. She's very, very much not happy to be there, as you pointed out. Then things start to get a little bit cray-cray.
Yeah, you see, Claire is, because she's in this disturbing place once again, is obviously going to be inflicted by all kinds of memories and daydreams and hallucinations and whatnot and, you know, seeing things that may not or may not be there, such as her old imaginary friend, which we're introduced to, like, in the very beginning of the film, which is able to very coolly communicate by touching through the wall. That was pretty cool.
Yeah.
But visions of that plague her throughout, and as a result, she ends up going on a bit of a mental breakdown, which is kind of exacerbated by the husband's ad hoc dosing of the girl.
You know, I think he thought he was doing good.
Dude, when you take it upon yourself to medicate somebody else, whether you think you're doing good or not, it's always a dangerous proposition.
You know, I self-medicate regularly.
Self. Self. That's the difference.
True. So, it does turn out that the medication has some adverse side effects on her as well.
Well, it doesn't, because at the same time, as I said, we do see that hand creeping through at the beginning. So,
yeah,
there is the paranormal aspect to it, which is fueling these delusions, which kind of send her down a spiral and at one point a staircase.
Okay, it exacerbated it so more than...
Yeah, probably. You know, it's not helpful when you're seeing things and then you're actually seeing things.
Yeah, true. It's basically like Corey Feldman's character in Friday the 13th 5.
Oh yeah, he was actually
where he was dreaming about Jason following him around the place, and everyone was telling him he wasn't there, and then it turned out that Jason was actually following everyone around the place.
So Claire like insists that her imaginary friend pushed her down the stairs.
Yeah.
Aaron, the husband, is obviously not believing it, and
as she had a previous suicide attempt before.
Well, yeah, but there was also the fact that they find out that she's pregnant, and this brings up the fact that they had a stillborn child before, which part of her going into previous mental breakdown, her getting doped up. She says that she doesn't want to live like a zombie like that again, which I think was Aaron's cue to kind of start doping her up himself.
Yeah, it was literally instantaneously. It was like, I don't want to be a zombie like that.
Okay, oh, don't worry, you won't be, darling. Here's your tea.
Yeah. Time to take your meds. In his defense, she was going a little bit cuckoo for Cocoa Puffs herself before.
Yeah, well, being back in a haunted house with terrible memories will do that.
Yeah.
Cue Tom Green, their Skype in fucking counselor.
And eventually live in house counselor as well.
Yeah, because it does get to that stage. He tries to talk them.
Which, believe it or not, guys, because you might find it odd to see Tom Green in any form of mental
ridiculously Dr. Phil approach.
Yeah, but he's very, very believable as a psychiatrist.
Yeah,
There are psychiatrists that kind of take things a little more, as you point, like hands-on.
Touchy-feely.
Yeah, he's kind of like, let's everybody hug, sit down. But I feel they've kind of been in counselling for so long. He's, as they said, he's like a member of the family and stuff as well. So
also
it's not
true. There is a clear relationship here that's a little bit more than just patient and doctor. But he sees the signs as well, and things get progressively worse as... While she does come home from the hospital, there's another incident where she's taking a shower and she starts having another trip whereby it revolves around pieces of thread being plucked from the skin, and that ties into
there's a very cool scene when she's like doing her hair in the mirror.
Yeah, and well, she's with the makeup brush, and she envisions herself stabbing it in and then.
There's like this one little hair there, and then she goes to touch the hair, and then when she goes to pull her hand away. This massive thread follows it out, and then she kind of like touches her face like that, and then all of a sudden
her entire face is held together with her fingers through thread. This happens again in the shower, except
very Freddy Kruegerish kind of visual, I suppose, for lack of a better word.
This happens again in the shower, only this time we get an almost ring-like vision of what turns out to be Bethany herself standing in front of her and push the hair away, and it's the masked face underneath, and she freaks out, hits a railing. Aaron's outside demanding that she let him in because he's type A stereotypical freak out and worried that she's doing something to herself again, clearly. But that's all cool, and the psychiatrist comes along and they're having a lovely little dinner when her psychosis or delusions or ghostly imaginary pissed off friend decide to intervene once again, leading to a rather bloody incident in the kitchen and another trip to the ER ward.
Yeah, much larger.
Yeah,
cash than normal.
Yeah, basically in trying to get away from the vision of Bethany, she does herself a bit of a mischief.
Okay. what a good description.
And in the proper way to do it, I might add. If you're going to do yourself a mischief, that's how you do it.
Oh, yes. Yeah. She doesn't do it by halves. And then I'm a little bit reluctant to go further into the film. I want people to go and watch it.
Yeah, basically it ends up with a further spiralling down, and events happen that lead to the invariable certain people realising that, you know, maybe she's actually not as nook and futs as we thought, and there's something going on here. And, you know,
your catchphrase, actually.
Nook and futs. Yeah. That actually is one of my catchphrases.
Okay, well, there you go. That's getting t-shirted.
Oh, crap. But, it pretty much goes from there. And I have to say, the effects in this film are fantastic. I love the look of Bethany herself, and I love her interactions. Certain parts of it I thought were a little bit drawn out because, I having seen similar stories in other cases before, but overall I thought, you know, the look of it's very good.
It was shot in the red anyway, number one, so the quality of the footage and everything is going to be absolutely
clearly
impeccable.
These things I don't.
just the flow of the... sequences between shots and stuff. It was a very there wasn't any kind of hard cuts. It was a very nice,
seamless, smooth,
smooth as hell. Like real professional quality looking movie.
I really liked the there's a scene that basically explains Bethany, and I liked the visceral nature of it, is the best way of putting it.
It's dark.
Shannon Doherty, really, like, you really get the sense of this is, like, she is...
She does an amazing job of being the mother. Like, she's actually...
Her portrayal of what can only be described as a...
Bipolar.
She's not bipolar, though.
Yeah. No, I'm just saying, like, behavior, like...
Yeah, I mean, the reasoning for why her character is the way it is explained as part of the Bethany origin. And you can see where a mental break happens and where she fixates on the notion that beauty is everything. And to that regard, she has Claire as a young girl participating in beauty pageants the whole time.
Beauty pageant after beauty pageant after beauty
much
pageant.
Much of the abuse that Claire suffers under... what's the name of the mother? Susan.
Yes.
Much of the abuse that Claire suffers under Susan takes the form of almost like lessons that Susan's, you know, giving to Claire in regards to these beauty pageants and in regards to how she should behave and how she should act, and completely drives it into her head that the external is everything. How you look is everything. To the point that eventually Claire, at the age of 17, goes
packs
screw
a
this.
Bindle, gets a stick and
screw this for a tub of shit. I am outie.
Yeah, she's gone by the age of 17, I think it was.
Yeah,
she
says that she runs.
Which you can't really blame her for.
No, not really.
The mother's the mother's verging on torture.
Oh, that's no, it's not verging. It is torture.
Yeah, a little bit.
And when we see...
interludes of love.
It's not love.
Which probably makes it even worse. Is that delusion of love?
No, it's not love. It's reflection.
Okie dokie.
There are... One of the things that Aaron points out when they get into the house is there are photos...
You should be a psychiatrist, kids.
No, there's reasons that I can't be. One of the things that Aaron points out is that all throughout the house there are pictures that Aaron mistakes for being Claire. And they're not. They're actually her mother when she was younger. And as a result of that, you can easily see the fact that, as I said, once this...
The mother never really dealt with getting out of her 20s. Well.
No, it's not that. Once this mental break happens, and there's a reason for this particular fixation, which I don't want to get into because it will spoil things.
Yeah.
But once this happens, it causes Susan to fixate on, as I said, beauty. And more importantly, to see Claire as being a reflection of herself and to make that reflection as perfect as it can be, to counteract this thing that causes her break. It is a direct opposite anthema to, you know,
what... It's just projection.
It is. Yeah. It's a projection onto Claire of what she wants herself to be, of how she should be, and a rejection of this thing she sees in herself, which caused her mental break caused by an actual event.
True.
Jesus Christ, you're right. I should be a psychiatrist. No, but I can't be. There's reasons.
If you think Giz should be a psychiatrist, message us on the YouTube page. There's Mike. Mike, do you think Giz should be a psychiatrist?
The answer is no.
He's not typing.
Yeah, he knows better. all in all, Bethany does give, you know, as I said, it does give a fantastic representation of how one person's mental break can
no.
be...
No! Exclamation mark.
Yeah, well, that kind of explains it. Bethany gives a perfect example of how one person's mental break can lead to A, the destruction of somebody else's psyche, and B, the creation of a very malevolent force.
Yes.
Which is hilarious, because in dealing with the situation that they had to deal with, Claire and Aaron inadvertently create a potential malevolent force in and of themselves.
Yes.
Because that was a very EGS thing for them to do at the end of that fucking film.
Yes.
It was hilarious.
I'm not going to say any more because we don't want to ruin the movie. And I got warrants.
You got caught.
No.
Good. Fuck's sake, sitting with some old warrants. Sloppy. Sloppy. They weren't sloppy in that film.
No, it was very well done. Very well done. I liked how we covered that there. Just tiptoed around all of the actual info.
Yeah. That's how I roll.
So then they all kind of just pack up and leave.
Yeah, well...
There's a little more to it.
As I said, we don't want to go into it because, to be perfectly honest, some of the best parts of the film are the resolution, I guess is the best way of putting it. the discovery of certain facts, the resolution of those facts, dealing with certain things that have happened.
The story does unfold phenomenally well.
If slowly.
A bit slowly, yeah.
Only, I think only because I have seen similar stories before, and as a result, once again, I always have to say it. One of the downsides of having basically digested as many stories as I have over the decades is that eventually certain things...
That many decades?
Three of them?
A bit.
Yeah. But it's a lot of story, and I don't remember reality that well.
No.
My brain, like my memory function goes to fiction before it actually... I can't remember what I had for dinner yesterday, apart from the fact that it was probably the same thing I had for dinner today, because I'm that, kind of,
nuggets.
I'm that kind of person. Well, that's all I have to eat at the moment. I'll get burgers and I'll get burgers and sausages in the next few days.
Name me other items out of your food list, guys.
Pizza, bread, cheese.
I thought you had funny words for everything.
No.
Burgulars.
Burgigulars.
Burgigulars?
Yeah, double cheese burgigulars.
Burgigulars? Chuck nuggets and...
Sausages.
Okay, no, it's sausages.
Chippy chips.
Chippy chips.
Can we get back to the film?
Yeah, sorry.
Off my limited dietary requirements.
Yeah. It's just certain... You have certain nuances about you that still, after 20 fucking odd years of friendship, still crack me up.
Yeah, and certain nuances that after 20 years of friendship, if you learned, would make you run screaming into the night.
It's okay. I'll be strong like Hulk. Kind of. It'll be okay. Don't worry. Anyway.
So now what?
I don't know. Where were we on the film? We were talking...
Well, we basically decided that we weren't going to spoil too much.
No, we're not
going
to spoil anything. Okay, I'm good when you are. Okay, cool.
Ah, excellent! And on that note, it seems that we might have our interview coming right on time.
I'll call James here, and we'll turn James's...
That right there was serendipitous.
Nice.
I try to fuck up people's vocabulary as much as I possibly can.
I like the magazine James is chewing on.
Scream, an American werewolf in London.
Do some werewolf episodes soon, maybe?
We like it, werewolfies.
Not what I was actually going to say, but yes, okay.
Okay, we obviously, something's going on here, so we'll just give James another moment or two. Okay, so we'll just drop it. Oh no, that's us. Whoops.
And we're back.
And we're gone again. And we're back. I don't know, just got a... Oh, hello.
Yay, interview.
Excellente. We're going to have to turn this up a tiny bit, I think. Hello.
Hey, what's up?
What's crack, dude? How are you? Are you able to get your camera on?
Oh, I didn't know this is a video thing. I didn't know that.
Yeah, if you want, yeah.
Oh, okay. Well, I just got back from the gym, but sure. We'll do a video.
Okay. So anyway, while we wait for the video to load up, we're here with James Cullen, who's been getting his burn on.
Wait a minute, how we know?
So. As we were explaining to you earlier, James is the director and co-writer of...
And producer
of Bethany, and you might also know him from To Jennifer, which was a very cool movie out in 2013.
At Jennifer. To Jennifer is the upcoming sequel, I think.
No, there's To Jennifer, T-O, and then there's To Jennifer with the number 2.
Oh, that's why I got confused.
There you go.
Yeah.
So, we've been filling everybody in on...
The general synopsis
of the film and stuff. What we'd like to know is kind of how did you get into doing the filming and everything in general first?
You mean like this?
No, like kind of like how did you end up kind of getting into shooting movies and everything in the first place?
So grew up around movies. Like passionate. I was like, you know, wanted to make movies. I was like, you know, people wanted to be like a famous, you know, sports person or this. I wanted to be a filmmaker. Specifically, I wanted to be Quentin Tarantino, actually. But
he's one of my favorites.
So, you know, growing up, I was a kid that, like, in school, they'd give me a book report. I would make a short film about why I didn't want to do a book report.
So, I used to do stuff like that as well.
Always into movies. And so when I graduated from high school, I was like, you know, I'm going to make a movie. Robert Rodriguez only needed $7,000, so I need to get $7,000 to make my movie. Yeah. And so I did My Pure Joy for like $7,000, my first film, and I just kind of went for it. And from there, I've just, you know, kind of kept going, or at least tried to.
One of the things that I've loved about the movies that you brought, like, I loved the fact that you did such a cool story and everything with to Jennifer on such a, it was all shot on an iPhone 5, basically, wasn't it?
Yeah, the whole thing was shot on an iPhone 5.
Who's got, there's Tristan Risk was in it, or
Jessica Cameron,
good old EGS friend of ours. So, but, like, how did you come up with the idea just to shoot a whole movie on an iPhone 5? Was there a big budget involved?
No, it was like, so minimal budget-wise, but I came up with the idea specifically because I was, like, you know, for a while I was preaching the idea of, like, you know, go out there and, like, make a movie. Like, you could just, you know, you can make it with anything that you want.
Yeah.
You know, whatever budget. And, you know, while saying that, like, people started calling me hypocritical because my first movie I made for $7,000, and people were like, yeah, well, I don't have $7,000. You know, like, I thought that was super low budget, but they're like, you know, you can't just say that because you had somebody who gave you $7,000, right? So I was like, well, you know, you can make something with anything. So, like, I was practicing what I preached, and I made a movie with an iPhone and no budget. There's kind of show, like, hey, like, this is what, like, you really could make a movie with anything.
Yeah, well, I mean, like, the quality on the phones and stuff have gone so good anyway. The video quality on the phones have gone so good even since the iPhone 5. Like, you literally could just go out there with a phone and shoot a movie.
I know, there's one that shoots 4K now.
It's crazy. I have the HTC 10 over here. It shoots 4K. We were shooting the studio Gorecast show off it for
a good while,
and it was absolutely awesome. And then we just decided to go back onto the camera. Sundance.
iPhone.
There was a film in Sundance that was all on an iPhone.
Yeah.
As you said, there's if you've got a story to tell, you don't really need a huge budget to do it. Do you know what I mean?
Well, I mean, I think it's Alfred Hitchcock who said, like, the three most important things to making a good movie are the script, and the script.
100%. Now, as we've mentioned to all of our viewers and stuff, the main reason that we have James on with us today is because he's actually doing a new film called Bethany, which we gave you a quick rundown on. How was it sitting down writing a story with Zack Ward, actually, number one? Because I'd only noticed when I was going through the list that it was co-written by him as well.
So Zack and I have been collaborating for a while. We've written something like 6 or 7 screenplays together. So, you know, yeah, we definitely enjoy writing together. We've become quite the writing team. So, it was a fun experience, obviously, because we repeated it. And Zack, if you're listening, talented mofo, but I doubt he's listening because he doesn't like me. I'm just totally kidding. He totally adores me, but I just, you know, I know he's not listening because he's tired of hearing my voice.
You can get there, I suppose. Myself and this chap are locked in the studio with each other for many hours a week. We need our day off. We need our days off time. The kind of the storyline through Bethany, I like how it's this kind of downward spiral, as you kind of put it earlier, through kind of
basically
a mental breakdown / also she's actually been haunted to hell.
It's hilarious to see somebody that's going through what is clearly a mental breakdown caused by, for want of a better term, PTSD through her mother.
Yeah.
But at the same time, she's actually seeing shit, you know?
Yeah. I mean, that's kind of what I wanted to play with in the movie, where it's like, you know, every scene it makes you go like, is she crazy or is this really going on? And like, I think heighten the reality and play a lot with her psychosis and a lot, like, visually, like, the movie starts to get like trippier and trippier as it goes on, and everything starts kind of melding together and little things will trigger stuff. And, you know, there's, like, that serial thief, for instance, like, you know, he says
love
something
that.
With the memory of her mother that suddenly compounds with a haunting at the same time. So you're like, oh,
yeah.
Shit, like, what is going on?
I always love those kind of food shots where they're infested with, like, always reminds me a little, reminds me a bit of The Lost Boys.
Oh,
you know, kind of the
noodles.
Worms, Michael, the worms. I always love that kind of thing. You could understand where Zach Ward's character was coming from as well, because she was there kind of like, why don't you believe me? And you're kind of sitting there going, well, there's...
You're a bit,
you
know. You
haven't given me a lot of compounding evidence to
yeah.
the contrary.
It was pretty nutso. And, you know, I... by the way, behind you, you're the wall behind you is probably going to fight with my arm.
Oh, no. We got a Freddy on an arm. We got a Jason on the wall. I've got the two guys from Breaking Bad on my leg. So, so that'll
right.
be good.
I got a Devil Man on my chest.
You got it. Oh, yeah, that's good. That's actually a pretty cool, awesome Battle Royale fighting team going on there.
Yeah.
I got a Chucky on my arm.
How does your arm not tear itself apart? Because I imagine Chucky and Freddy wouldn't like each other too much.
No. Freddy, as we discussed with the Freddy versus Jason, neither of them like their kills getting taken out.
Yeah.
What was I saying before Chucky thing?
Psychological messing with people's heads.
Psychological messing. Oh, yes. Okay. It's gone out of my head. Oh, yeah, the Zach Ward thing. That was it. Yeah, you could see how his character was kind of getting a bit mental. Visually, when, as you said, it starts to get a lot trippier as you're going along, the shower scene always sticks out with me.
I like that. Just the, you could see where it was going, but just for the first time, we got a proper look at the masked face. And I just liked the pattern of it, the stitching going through it.
Yeah, you don't really see her proper, like, do anything until, like, she kind of pushes her down the stairs. Where it's just the arm comes out of the wall. It's the first time you get a full reveal. I'm a big Tom Green fan. How, I have to ask, just kind of with his kind of background and what he used to do, how did you come to the conclusion, psychiatrist?
You know, Tom is a really nice, funny, person, but you know there's a lot of depth to him.
Yeah,
and in talking with him, it just seemed, you know, the right thing to do. Like, he seemed like a perfect fit. I mean, he's actually like a very calm person outside of the you know, the limelight and it, you know, when he's performing. And so I think it really translated to the screen. Like, you see, I think people really are going to see a side of Tom they didn't know existed, which is a really interesting experience for this movie.
Because, like, one of the first things I said to Giz when he came down to the studio today, because we kind of customarily, normally would watch the film separately so we can kind of make our own little notes and then kind of compare when we come down. And the first thing that came out of my mouth was, I was like, I can't believe how believable as a psychiatrist.
Yeah.
Like, he was nearly like
Dr. Phil-esque,
as you said. He wasn't just like the typical, you know, psychiatrist kind of character. He was really kind of hands-on, real invested into the client's. Although I feel like there's kind of a bigger friendship there than just a client basis. I kind of picked up on with the relationship between himself and Zach Ward mostly.
Yeah. I mean, it was very interesting, and I you know, obviously he definitely cared.
Yeah.
And it's I think it's, you know, Tom's character is actually like kind of the rock in the movie, like the constant, like, you know.
Yeah.
Character, which is a really interesting thing to say, because he's the person kind of like trying to help them hold themselves together, which is just,
yeah.
I think it's something that nobody, you know, 10 years ago would have ever said they would see Tom Green doing. So I think it's really interesting to do that, and I think he really nails it. You know, I'm really fortunate enough to have had him involved. And I'm very excited that that people seem to agree that it's a side of him that they did not know existed.
But you never get to see him do anything. You haven't really seen him do anything serious.
Most of his roles being somewhat comedic.
Yeah, even like the talk show and stuff like that was kind of a comedy-ish kind of vibe to it. And I would 100% agree with you. He's like so
zany.
no, not Zany. Like in the movie, he's just so well put together as the character. It might get him out into doing some more kind of character based stuff like that.
I mean, I'd love to see Tom, you know, doing a lot more stuff like that. I mean, I think there's a lot more depth to him than people realize. And, you know, I think we just, you know, scratched a little bit of the surface here with Tom. And I, you know, I'd love to see him. I think he would play a great killer.
Yeah.
He was brilliant in, have you seen Swearing Out?
No, I haven't.
He was in that, and he goes like it's basically a comedy thing with the guys from Trailer Park Boys, where they're outside of the trailer park. Long story, but anyway, there's a big fight scene at the end of it. I could totally like where he goes fucking apeshit on one of the guys from the Trailer Park Boys. It's one of the best fights you're ever going to see. I mean, like it's just brilliant. But like I could actually see him going like that crazy kind of serial killer route, or even like a Norman Bates-ish kind of character. He's got
I see him play like Jack Nicholson's character in The Shining sometime. I think that'd be a fun, fun, you know.
Yeah.
Imagine that. Like, I think he'd do that well. To be honest,
he seems like a guy who, whatever kind of role he's going to do, he just will jump, you know, legs first into it.
Yeah, he was really dedicated, and it was great to see him in that craft. You know, he was really excited and a pleasure to be on set with.
That's good. I'd say he's probably, as you said, he's just an all around nice chap anyway.
Well, yeah, he's Canadian, right?
Oh, okay. Well, that's fair enough.
They even make mention of that in the film.
Yeah. Some racial stereotypes.
Actually, I think what they say is that, politeness is their secret weapon.
Yeah. It's the same way that if you come to an Irish person's house, they have to unload every bit of food they have in your fridge in front of you and let you eat all of it, basically. That's put the spread out.
Poor Canadians, your stereotype is that you're too nice. Oh, God.
Yeah, wait, it's an easy,
except if you're Logan.
Except if you're Logan.
Or Wade.
But I feel that you won't, after meeting them,
go to a hockey game.
Hockey game isn't nice. But it's nice for the people not on the rink. Shannon Doherty. As everybody would know her from the 1990s Beverly Hills 90210 and the very long running late 90s and 2000s
Charmed.
Her character literally blew me away. She was so you nearly felt so bad for her, but
once you realise what triggered it, you're kind of like but at the same time it's kind of like, okay, you were destined to snap about something eventually, and this just happened to be it, I think. But
yeah, she's very scary in the movie. I personally feel like it's one of Shannon's best performances. And I've told Shannon that many times. I think it's a really dark thing where I don't think both Shannon and Tom got to play stuff that I don't think anybody's ever seen that side of them.
She had a bit of a dark side to her in Charmed. A little bit. Yeah, well, it was TV diluted.
It's dark. Way darker than that, though.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. No, that's way. No,
There's a specific basement scene where she doesn't say anything that is just terrifying.
Yeah. I was actually commenting on that earlier, the fact that that scene is the visceral nature of it, and the way it's done, it was a standout scene for me. The origin,
and how calm she is.
Yeah,
it's scary.
They're always the kind of the scariest psychos as well, where they don't have that outward anger. It's just, you know, I'm doing it. As I said, we only went through a certain amount of the story because I do want people to go off and watch the movie and not just run off the synopsis and everything that we're talking about. But it's hard to explain. There, as you said, there's a big incident that happens in the film, and it's what is the trigger for her going mental. So there's this certain sympathetic feel for her, while also absolute.
No, there's a certain disgust. There's a certain amount of understanding for why it happened.
Okay, that's better. Thank you.
But at the same time, it doesn't exactly lend itself to an awful lot of sympathy for the character.
Yeah.
Considering her actions to what her reaction. to what happened.
Yeah.
But it does certainly explain, as I said, why basically she fixates on the notion of physical perfection and drives it into Claire and has her going into all
the beauty pageants.
And it's a reflection.
Oh, we lost James.
No, I'm still here.
Oh, okay. That's okay. Sorry, the video disappeared there for a second.
I heard you guys. It just, my screen went black for a second. I don't know why.
No, it's okay. I was looking at the timer and was like, oh no, the timer's still running. Yeah.
But I thought it was good the way that it explains why she saw herself in her daughter, why she fixated so much on outer perfections, why she became basically psychotic as a result of it, and why she eventually became so callous when it came to certain other people and certain other events. And it's a nice little, you did a good job of explaining.
Yeah. The layout of the character development through the whole movie is done very, very well. Like Zach Ward's character, you kind of feel from her a bit, and then he starts dosing her up with the meds, and you're kind of like, okay, what?
Yeah, it was just that all of a sudden, you know, off his own bat, here's your tea, which happens to be like fucking roofied.
And I think the thing about that is, like, you know, he's hit his breaking point. Like,
yeah,
you know,
yeah.
This is, he loves her and cares about her. She's not taking the medication that helps her with her psychosis, and he knows it, and he's scared for her. So his reaction is to
dose her
because it's like, well, if she's not going to take care of herself, maybe I can help. And you see that rationale, and even though what he does is, I think it's incorrect and it's horrible that he does it.
I got it.
Understand why he goes to that, because he's hit his breaking point of, like, he can't see her tear herself apart anymore, because from the outside perspective, what he's seeing, she is literally losing her mind.
Yeah, and at certain points, she is literally losing her mind as well a little bit.
Yeah, I think it's right after that. It's like you were saying earlier, the way you were able to blur the line between what is in her mind and what is supernatural in origin. I think that trip down the stairs happens after he doses her. So even he's kind of going, you can see that he's kind of scratching his head going, well, maybe this, you know, I think she might have just done herself a mischief because I dosed her or something. Yeah.
Yeah.
I could easily see that being what's going through his head there, you know?
Yeah.
Well,
like, with, you can tell that there's been some serious mental issues between them as a couple from the very start of the film, because even when they move into the house, now granted, she never wanted to move back to that house anyway, so she's already tense, but there's this kind of...
tension between
it's acted out very well, because it's not literally written, it's kind of like this unwritten tension that's just, you know, they're having completely normal dialogue with each other, but
body
it's just
language.
This very body language, and they're very walking on eggshells.
That's a lot how I worked with the actors on how I wanted them to perform it, and then there was, you know, there's also the perfect way. This was not written, but this was on the day, in the moment, this is how I directed and wanted the scene, and I think it sets up their relationship perfectly. The first scene that they are together in, she doesn't look at him.
He's at all.
Talking to her, and she's looking away from him for the entire scene until the very end of it, in the car.
Yeah, because she's nearly like a huffy kid in the car. She's like, you can tell she does not want to be in that house before she even gets in the door of it.
Yeah.
The two of them play out the relationship side of it very, very well. You do feel for Zach Ward, you feel for Stephanie's character, and you feel for Zach Ward's character as well, because it's, you know, it's trying on both sides of it. For any sports fans, some of the other names that were in the movie, because I'm a serious UFC fan.
He fixated on this.
The Dean of Mean, I love him, he's unbelievable.
We were talking about the cast, and we were talking about the names that were in it, and we were talking about we'd actually mentioned, oh yeah, that scene where the nurse or the orderly comes down and was like, yeah, I know his face as well. He turns around and is like, of course you do, he's a fighter, and blah, blah, and I'm like, okay.
I've watched zero UFC fights in my life, you have.
I'm not a UFC fan, I've watched K1.
He knocked out Liddell, how do you not know this?
I don't know who Liddell is either.
He's the Iceman, it's Chuck, oh dude.
The Iceman was a mafia killer.
Chocolate, dude, you need to, that man, I like watching wrestling, but
the
ground
game in UFC often bores me to tears, I'm sorry.
It's no ground game, no ground game with Liddell.
First stand-up fight.
No ground game with Liddell.
I accept that.
Okay. I saw on your page that you have another movie coming out on, is it LMN?
Yeah, so it's playing again on LMN, which is Lifetime.
Yeah.
But it's called If Looks Could Kill. It's played a couple times already, and it's also out on DVD now as well, and VOD.
That's cool. The trailer looked absolutely fantastic.
I wrote that one together as well.
You which? You wrote that?
And I also wrote that one together too.
Oh, that's cool. And do you have a lot more projects coming out together?
I think that's the last one. Oh, no, we have... him and I wrote Circus Kane together. I didn't direct that. That was directed by Chris Solon Ray, but that's a... It's a fun, crazy, crazy clown circus haunted house room movie.
Oh, yeah.
Escape room movie.
It's basically like, you know, 10 contestants go into a haunted house, slash escape room, and they find out with the promise that, like, if they can get out alive, quote-unquote, they'd get, like, $250,000. But then they find out halfway through that this is not a joke. This is not for fun. This is a real, legitimate thing.
Yeah.
And there are killers in this maze.
Yeah. Win or die. Yet.
Okay, I want to see that when it comes out.
Yeah, I definitely want to check that one out.
It's a wild, wild movie.
So, Bethany is out on VOD now.
Out on the 7th of April.
7th of April. So next month, make sure to go check out that. Next week. God, I've completely lost.
About two weeks.
Yeah. We'll say next month. So make sure to go check that out. Hopefully you'll enjoy it as much as we did. It's also hitting cinemas?
Yep, it is. On the same day.
Kind of limited release cinema or worldwide?
Yeah, limited release. Are you guys, where are you guys?
We are in Ireland.
It is not coming to Ireland.
Okay, so April 7th, you can get it on VOD, and you can order DVDs and stuff of that, and Blu-rays. So people in Ireland who will enjoy this story, and if you were mad to see Tom Green in a way never seen before, and Zach Ward in a... Well, no, you... Zach Ward in a way.
Seen him being a type A kind of...
Well, that makes a lot of sense why you're super into UFC, because the pride of Ireland...
Oh.
Right now.
Connor. Oh, yeah.
See, at least you recognize he's Irish. Ask an Englishman where he's from. I dare you.
The English are renowned for... We're Irish when we're losing, and when we're winning, we're all English.
Did you know...
He's the pride of Ireland.
He's the pride of Ireland. He's the first one to tell you that. You saw, when BBC called him English, they weren't long fucking retracting it. He literally... you could change that now, please. Thank you very much.
There was a Limerick actress that, if you ask English... Because she won an award, if you ask...
Ruth Negga.
Yeah. If you ask the English, apparently she's British. But no, she's from Limerick, where we're actually from.
Yeah. She's Limerick Lass and Jimmy Carr, all of those guys. Yeah. So, on that, because we're coming near the end of the show, we're going to pop away to an advert from our sponsor in a second, and then we're going to come back and we're going to play the Bethany trailer for you guys and have a little quick chit-chat. We'd like to thank Mr. Bressack, James Cullen Bressack, for coming on.
Cheers for coming on, man.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for having me. And,
yeah.
If you're listening, follow me on Twitter at James Cullen B and say hi.
We will indeed, and I'm sure many other people out there will hop on board as well. I'm sure we'll stay in touch anyway, and I'll hopefully get a chat with you when the clown movie comes out.
Awesome, yeah. Definitely. And everybody, thank you, and please watch Bethany. I think you guys are going to like it.
I think people are going to like it as well.
Yeah.
So on that, we're going to cut away to our advert from Hart D. Fisher's American Horrors, and we'll come back and we'll show you the trailer from Bethany. All right, James, thank you very much. And
bye, guys.
See you later, man.
Toodaloo.
Lads, I'm so fucking bored. Weird. I don't remember turning the TV on.
Welcome to the new American Horror Channel on Roku. Streaming 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, all night, all day, all horror. Hi, I'm Hart D. Fisher. As owner and operator of the world's greatest uncut 24 hours a day, 7 days a week horror channel, American Horrors, it's my job to let you know that I'm choking to death on this smoke.
Okay, we're still rolling, right?
Mother only cared about what she wanted, not what I wanted. on it. It's just impossible to be around.
Beauty is just so brief.
You're angry. Now let's talk about why.
Again!
This house, being here feels wrong.
You have a nightmare?
Yeah. Ah!
Claire, you're in the hospital. You're not suggesting something supernatural.
This house is doing horrible things to her psyche, and I suggest you don't bring her back.
That's crazy. Don't call me that.
No.
There we go. So that was the trailer for Bethany. So hopefully you guys will go out there and check that out. As we said, it's a real bit of a thrill ride, I suppose, for lack of a technical term, through mental breakdowns.
One person's psychosis.
And another person's possession.
Well, nobody's possessed.
Haunting. So another person's haunting. God, that thing really blew up my mouth. Take it away there for a minute.
Apologies, folks, but... The Deadly One has decided that he's going to smoke one of those...
I vaped in between the ad break and it nearly exploded my mouth, so...
I keep saying they're dangerous. No one believes me. I'm going to have to start booby-trapping more of them.
So, the reason we pop back is just to say, yet again, thanks to James for popping on the show and chatting with us about the movie and about some of his other stuff that's been going on.
I'm really looking forward to that film, that clown film.
That clown movie sounds, that's like right up our street.
Yeah.
Right up the street, where people think it's a joke that they're going to get killed, but they're actually going to get
killed. It's not for fun.
It's like Saturday night with Giz.
Don't tell them that, no one will come to my parties.
No worries. So the reason we're also popping back is just to let you know that if you want to help DGS keep doing what we're doing and getting some cool guests on and stuff like that, pop over to our Patreon page. Go to Patreon and take a look at Emerald Gore. You can throw us a donation there. As I so aptly put it yesterday on Anna Nightmares, that if you don't like just donating, by all means feel free to go over to the Teespring account and you guys get yourself an awesome Gorecast t-shirt, or there's another double-sided Gorecast t-shirt which has the first rule of the Fight Club series, first rule of Gorecast, which is...
Don't talk about Gorecast?
It was probably a bad choice in my designing of that. You probably should talk about the Gorecast, but for the sake of it looking good on the soap, we'll put links in the little description box below this so you can follow them over to Teespring and stuff. And make sure to go check out James's page on Twitter, and make sure to check out me on Twitter, which is at Johnny Deadly. Giz isn't allowed on Twitter because he's not allowed to interact with the public. Or you can check Giz out on the Facebooks, if you look up The Giz.
Or The Metal Show.
Or The Metal Show, if you want to listen to some absolutely hardcore, but sometimes not hardcore, but always metal tunage, you can check Giz out on Limerick City Radio on a Friday night, which this is.
Oh, I meant to check, yeah.
It's okay. So at some stage, somewhere, you could have possibly even listened to myself and Giz live now, while also in the background listening to Giz not live from Wednesday.
Yes.
At some stage.
Yeah.
Possibly. What else do we have to do? T-shirts covered. There's also some really bitchin' mugs, actually. There's the Fight Club Gorecast mug.
Which, this is news to me.
This is going to be the first thing you ever hear me talking about in relation to any colours whatsoever, but it's so dope looking in white, it's not even effing funny. It looks impeccable. I'm actually going to pull up a picture of it before we cut away. I'm going to pull up a picture of it, that's how good it is. And people can have a look at the Teespring account and see where these Teesprings are.
Teesprings, we're pulling up a picture, doing the Teespring. Go, Teespring.
Johnny spent a lot of time...
It's disturbing how excited you get.
Johnny spent a lot of time designing this faux shiz. Okay, right, so we just need to bring this in here now. And we'll do the window capture. I really wish I had thought about doing this
like 3 hours ago?
Well, not 3 hours ago, because it'll take me all of about 30 seconds to get
a work.
Yeah,
but if you thought about it 3 hours ago, then you would.
It'll be all ready now.
Yeah.
So, as you can see there, there's the back of the t-shirt, and we have First Rule of Gorecast, don't talk about Gorecast. And then you have the front of it, which looks remarkably like this. It also comes in mugs. The mugs are also...
Is that a hoodie?
They're also available in white. There is hoodies, which we'll be doing the normal Gorecast t-shirts, and there's some Giz-orientated clothing wear from the Gorecast coming out as well. Giz, because he doesn't use Photoshop, doesn't know what I'm doing, and it's highly hilarious. And there's also some girls' tees as well for the little ladies that want to wear me on their back and the Gorecast on their chest. I worded that very specifically. I won't lie to you, I hadn't...
I'm not saying
anything. It didn't sound as bad...
In your head?
It didn't sound as bad in my head.
Welcome to what happens every time I speak.
Yeah.
All the time. Okay, we're going to wrap things up there because at this stage we're kind of waffling a little bit.
I've already talked about mounting someone from the back and the Gorecast covering them from the front, so I think it's time to cut it.
You know you're in trouble when I'm the one not making the perverted references.
Yeah, that's 2 days in a row now.
I know, I'm being good.
Do you think that we've been working together for so long now?
That I've destroyed your brain?
That we've swapped personalities?
No. I infect other people.
Yeah, but I used to be the one going, Giz, you can't say that. Whereas now you're the one going, Johnny.
No, I'm not saying you can't. I'm just
too
saying.
Too far.
You know. Anyway, we'll be back Wednesday.
We will be back on Monday.
We're going to be back. Back in time.
Next week, there's a new layout for the show, which will be starting from, probably won't be this week, it'll be starting from the week after. So make sure to check out the Gorecast hashtag episode 14, or flashback episode, where we had a chat with Tom Costable from Voodoo.
Yeah.
The awesome movie that was out, starring Stuart. Crap, it's gone out of my head. Samantha Stewart. Thank
you. There
you go. Samantha Stewart. And
we also,
of other people.
Yeah, and we also do a review of He-Man.
No, it's not He-Man.
It's
technically a review of He-Man. Or Arrow.
Yeah.
Especially applicable for this week's episode.
Yeah. Yeah.
But what we're talking about is a movie that we covered before Christmas. That was still on a crowdfunder, actually, when we covered it.
Yeah, it was.
And then got... The crowdfunder was to get it publicly released. The movie was already made. I remember talking about this now. That's how it happened, because I was like, Jesus, they made that, turned it out
anyway,
pretty quick.
The film in question is
Don't
Kill
It, which you must go watch because it is awesome.
Yeah, and you can see our review of that and the interview with Tom Costable on Monday.
And you can also see myself and Giz teleport through time, which fucking hurts. Which is why we don't do it anymore.
Often.
Don't do it back to back anyway. Like it did to me, because I was puking for a week afterwards. It was just not good. So anyway, from the new little Gorecast chats segment that we're going to do, we have many more lined up for you, which will get revealed in the upcoming weeks and days. And there's also some very exciting news going to be coming out soon, which myself and you and Greeny were talking about.
Yeah!
Very exciting news.
I'll break your fingers.
What?
Never mind.
That's not cool, man. You can't break these fingers or the studio won't work. He needs my digits. Okay, so on that, from me, Johnny Deadly, and from the Giz.
Just looking for duct tape so that I can set it up something like these fingers.
I'm also the one that calls out the cue in and cues out, so literally, you literally can't gag me.
I didn't say I'd gag you.
What's the duct tape for?
To duct tape stuff onto your broken digits so you can use the keyboard.
Okay, I can't feel shit in that hand anyway, so it doesn't matter. It's like fucking literally dead as a dodo. It doesn't matter. It's just anyway. Long story, you know about it. Anyway, back to what we were doing a minute ago. From me, Johnny Deadly, and from the Giz, goodbye, and I'll let you say it this time.
Gorecast out.
Take two.
See, this is what happens when I say stuff.
Take two.
Gorecast out!